Welcome to this series of classes by Dr. Johnson C. Philip. He is a foremost Christian apologist and Bible expositor with a worldwide demand. Please press the subscribe button below this video and then please click the bell icon near it. This will ensure that you never miss any valuable video of Dr. Philip. God bless you.
We have been studying the subject of what the Bible teaches about itself. Bibliology. And the question is, why should we know about it? We should know about bibliology because so many books are competing today with each other. And in the 22nd century in which we live, 21st century in which we live, lot of Christians are there who would like to reduce the status of the Bible to that of any other book in this world. And often they use such persuasive words that we may fall for it. And therefore, we should definitely know about what the Bible says about the Bible. One request, Uncle Thomas Varghese is online and please be ready for closing prayer. Uncle Thomas Varghese for closing prayer. I'm giving advance notice because anything can go wrong technically these days. So, since people are trying to reduce the status of the Bible, each one of us should know exactly what the Bible says about itself. And last week, we came up to one point. And the point was, were books known when Moses is supposed to have written the Bible? This question comes up because a lot of theological radicals, I hope you remember that phrase which I mentioned before, theological radicals. They claim that Bible is like any other book in this world, and therefore Moses did not know the art of writing, and therefore Moses could not have written. I mentioned these tablets, Kish tablets, which were produced more than 2,000 years before the time of Moses. I also mentioned Ebla tablets. Ebla tablets were produced 1,000 years before Genesis. And Ebla tablets, they say that they were, many of the Ebla tablets were copies of books which were produced or tablets which were produced even 1,000 before years before Ebla tablets. So this way, we have multiple lines of evidence in biblical archaeology, which shows very clearly that writing was known at least 2,000 years before the time of Moses. Kish tablet is one example. Ebla tablets is an example of writing 1,000 years before Moses. But since many of those tablets are copies of tablets which were still 1,000 years old, excuse me. So we have three lines of evidence which shows that writing was known far, far, far before the time of Moses. Another question which I asked you, or which I asked in the class, was if books were known, if writing was known, were libraries known before the time of Moses? That's again a very interesting question. Were libraries known before the time of Moses? So let me introduce a library to you. Actually, this is a very massive structure. The picture does not make it very clear, but this is a very massive structure which is spread over several acres of land. And it is a library. Library of the Kingdom of Ebla, from where they were able to get 20,000 tablets or fragments of 20,000 tablets. You may ask, what are these tablets? Because these days we use the word tablet. Either to talk about computer tablets or about medical tablets. Let me show you a tablet. This is the thing which we are referring to as a tablet. What exactly is this? In Middle Eastern countries, they used to have very high quality of clay. The state where I am, Kerala, here also we have exceedingly high quality of clay. So high that vessels made of clay, just clay, that is mud, they are so good that in my childhood, my grandma used to cook rice in it. Rice in pots of mud. It was placed on hot fire, it would not crack. Even today, in Kerala, the best fish curry which Keralites make, they are made in mud vessels. My wife uses mud vessels for making fish curry. So the clay is so good, so strong, that once it is baked, it can be kept directly on furnace, gas. It is kept directly on gas where the flame is blue. And blue flame means 1200 to 1800 degrees centigrade. Doesn't break. Why? Clay is so good. North India, we don't have that much, that kind of a clay. So that's why I explained it to brothers that Kerala clay is very special. In the same way, in Middle East, they had clay which was of such high quality that it was used as a writing material. What kind of writing material? They would take clay, knead it, clean all the stones and particles from it, and then flatten it somewhat like a piece of bread, not the small bread that we are used to. Large kinds of breads are available. So the minimum size would be like the large size of bread. Once it is flattened, they would use a pointed device and they would then make these marks. This was their script. And then they would keep these clay tablets in sun. Middle Eastern sun is very, very strong. It would be like baked in a furnace. Not only that, special people were available in the Old Testament. They were known as scribes. Scribes were people who were trained in the art of writing. And they devoted their entire life to writing. Today, we don't have scribes. Today, we don't even have stenographers. But I'm sure that a lot of brothers and sisters who are listening to this class, they remember a category of people known as stenographers. A lot of young men and women from South India, once they pass 10th standard, they would go along with their school education, they would go and learn typing, and then they would learn shorthand, and they would become stenographers, which was a very highly paid job all over India, till the arrival of computers. Arrival of computers has taken away that job. Now there are very few stenographers, but that profession of stenographers shows people who are devoted to writing. I'm sorry, this is a very small picture, very, very small picture. Because of my sickness, I did not have time to enlarge the picture, but it shows a man who is sitting there. And in his lap, you can see a scale, a slate kind of thing. And he is writing. He is an Egyptian scribe. Actually, a lot of people devoted themselves to the art of writing. And since a lot of people devoted themselves to the art of writing, they had a professional name, and the name is scribe. So, a few questions that you should keep in mind when we discuss bibliology, because a lot of people come and ask about Bible, and also when Bible was written and was the art of writing known at that time. Excuse me for drinking from time to time, and excuse me the steel glass. This is a North Indian habit. I was brought up in North India, where we would have water in metallic glasses. Not very common in other parts of India. So, at the time of Moses, number first question, was the art of writing known? Yes, it was known 2000 years before the time of Moses, minimum. Were books known? Yes. Were libraries known? Yes. What kind of material did they use? One of the most common materials in Middle East was clay tablets, because high quality clay was available in abundance, which could be cleaned from dust and dirt, made into tablets. Writing on them was very easy with the help of a screwdriver kind of equipment, and once written and dried in the hot summer of Middle East, they would become permanent. So permanent that the Kish tablet, the first tablet that I showed you, they were produced in 3500 BC. And when we calculate it from today, that is 5,500 years old. And they have survived for 5,500 years. Today's books will not survive that much. Of course, the 21st century books, they may survive longer, but I'm sure that many are here, book lovers here, who have seen 18th and 19th century books, which become so fragile that the moment you touch them, the paper breaks down into pieces. But the clay tablets were so good, they survived for 5,500 years. That's the reason. No, they did not know that it is going to last for 5,500, but they did realize that it has lasting value. And that's the reason why they used clay for writing books on tablets. With that point covered, because a lot of people are going to ask you where books are, where was writing available, and that question is covered. Now let us ask the next question. for our own knowledge. And also when we speak about the scripture, a lot of people are going to ask this question. Were books common among the Jews when the Old Testament books were written? That's a very interesting question. And practically, almost every week I hear people attacking the Bible, particularly those who are devoted to attacking the Bible. They keep on claiming, no, the Jews, they did not have any books. They did not know about books. It's so surprising that these people read the Bible with closed eyes, or they have not read the Bible, they are just attacking it. Please turn with me to Genesis chapter 5, verse 1. This is the first mention in the Bible about book. Genesis chapter 5, verse 1 says, this is the book of the generations of Adam. We all read the history in Bible, but often we ignore statements like this because people who believe in the Bible, they have no problem. But people who believe in the Bible, when they answer those who don't believe, they should know. And they should know when the first reference came in the Bible. Thanks to Brother Johnson John, who has been posting these references. If anyone misses the reference that I mentioned, please look into the comment box. And Brother Johnson has always been very generous in adding these verses to the comment box. So the first mention of the word book in the Bible is Genesis 5:1. You may ask, Brother Johnson, what is this book? Generation of Adam or generations of Adam? It's a good question. See, when we study the Bible, we should be thorough with all possible aspects because we live in a generation where people are going to attack the Bible, more so when they come to know that you are a Bible-believing person, and therefore it is good to know all the aspects. Actually, when we study the Old Testament from Genesis up to Malachi, it becomes very clear that people were in the habit of writing books. People were in the habit of writing diaries. By diary, I don't mean paper diaries. And these days, in 21st century, diary writing has become extinct. But up to my generation, I remember a lot of people, they would sit at night, 5 to 15 minutes, note down all the important events of the day. That was known as diary writing. Some people would write it much more elaborately, so elaborately that they would not be able to show it to anybody. So many personal things. 21st century has taken away a lot of useful habits, and one of them is the habit of diary writing. I'm not saying that everybody who is listening to me should pick it up. If you pick it up, don't write unnecessary details in your diary. Okay, write only the essential data. This has been a human habit from the time of Adam. Oh, you may say, Johnson brother, do you mean to say that Adam was literate? Good question. Please remember, Adam was God's direct creation, and he was given so much knowledge and wisdom that he was able to name every animal. Please remember, naming animal is not an easy thing. A lot of animals look similar. Adam had to distinguish between them and then give names to them. From where did he get his vocabulary? Please check little children. they will manage with two or three syllables. Not with Adam. He named every species or every kind. The correct word would be kind, not species. Every kind of animal which God brought to him. So he had intelligence, he had perception, and he had vocabulary to name them. And the scripture says that whatever name he gave, it stuck to those animals, which means that in all probability, those names were also written down so that they are not forgotten from human history. How did he learn? Please remember, as far as Adam is concerned, since he was God's direct and mature creation, God must have introduced a lot of things to him. And once he named all animals, which came in pairs, God found that there was no suitable match for Adam. God created Eve. What is the first thing which Adam did after looking at Eve? He said, "Flesh of my flesh." She was taken from man, and therefore she will be called woman. He gave a name to Eve also. How did he have this knowledge that she is flesh of my flesh, that she was taken from me? It's obvious when we study the Old Testament narrative carefully, and when we analyze it, it becomes obvious that a lot of information was given by God. And therefore, we should not be surprised that the first alphabet was given to Adam by God, script was given by God, and Adam was able to write. The scripture here very clearly says that this is the book of the generations of Adam, which means that Adam was able to write. And what is the book of generation? Book of generation means genealogy of Adam, which once again reminds us that right from the time God created mankind, mankind was in the habit of noting down everything that was happening to him in his daily life. Not only genealogy, but a lot of things we read. Some of you who are good Bible students, let me suggest an assignment. Pick up a good Bible concordance, printed or electronic concordance, and search for the word book in the Bible. And you're going to be surprised at how much the Bible says about books, and also how many books were in existence right from the time of Adam. So we were handling the question, were books known to Jews? And I reminded you that not only the Jews, right from the time of Adam, books were known. The only difference, books were not made of paper, they were made of clay. Books were made not only of clay, eventually they also discovered a lot many more materials using which they wrote books. And Lord willing, we will pick up some of them. I'll give you illustration of some of them very soon. Let us read another verse from the Bible, and it is Exodus chapter 17 verse 14. Exodus 17 and 14. Here we read, "And the Lord said unto Moses," please note down, these are all very significant things when we study the Bible. "Lord said unto Moses, write this for a memorial in a book, and repeat it in the ears of Joshua." Why do people write diaries? Some people write diaries so that each and every important incident they remember. They may not forget. In some offices, some people write diaries so that how much work has been covered may be assessed. Some writers write diaries so that everyday events they might not forget and they might be able to add it into their books. A lot of people write books for different purposes. Here we read about a book of memorial. That means a book which contains things which are not to be forgotten, a memorial. And it is God himself who is asking Moses to write a book, which once again reminds that books were common, book writing was common, and writing books for remembering things was a common practice in the Old Testament. First, we saw about Adam. Excuse me. Adam's book is not the only book mentioned in Genesis. Genesis mentions many more books, but one example was sufficient. Now we have come to Exodus, where God is asking Moses to write a book for memorial, which means that books were written for various purposes. We saw book for of generations, book for memorial. We will see about a lot many more books in the Bible. Why was Moses supposed to write it? God says, and the Lord said unto Moses, write this for a memorial and read it in the ears of Joshua. Joshua was going to be the next leader of God's people. And every leader should definitely know the history of his people. Why should he know? Without knowing the history of a group of people, you cannot lead them. Please remember, whenever you have to lead a group of people, you need to have a good background about the people. Otherwise, you will not be able to lead them. I see this in my hobby, which is teaching. Now I don't do it, but when my children were studying in a school nearby, every year I used to go and help them, particularly in physics. And one thing which the principal repeatedly used to tell me was, sir, when you teach, there is pin drop silence. And I would always ask her, do you mean to say that when other teachers get into class, you don't get pin drop silence? And she always used to say, sir, any physics teacher goes into class, it's a noisy atmosphere. But I taught here in Ernakulam, I taught in two schools where my children studied and school people asked my help. So I taught in one school nearby, one school a little far. And in both places, they always said, sir, there is pin drop silence. Why? And why other teachers were not able to obtain pin drop silence? Lots of reasons are there. But one reason, whenever I went into class, I always tried to keep one thing in mind. When I studied physics, what were the topics that gave me maximum difficulty and headache? I would always recall the subjects that gave me maximum difficulty and headache. And those subjects, I used to explain to my students in the simplest possible words. And once suddenly the students realized that, that subject which we thought is so difficult, this sir is explaining in very simple words. they become silent. Knowledge of history, past history, always helps a person who is in leadership position. If you don't know your history, you will not be able to lead people. I gave a very simple example from classroom. A congregation of people is a far more complex crowd. In a classroom, if you have to know the past for effective class, when you lead a group of people, you definitely need to know the past before you can lead them. That's why God asked Moses to write and rehearse it to Joshua. When we study bibliology, please remember, we get information not only about the Bible, we get information about the entire area of human behavior. We read about another book in Exodus 24:7 says, and he took the book of the covenant and read in the audience, and they said, all that the Lord has said, we will do, and we will be obedient. Please notice, books were widely known to people of God. Books were very common among people of God. Books about various subjects were common. Books of genealogy, books of history, book of covenant. Not only that, even books in God's presence are mentioned in the Bible. Books in God's presence, yes. Exodus 32:33 says, and the Lord said unto Moses, whosoever has sinned against me, him will blot out of my book. Which means that the Jews very clearly knew that not only are there books in this world, there are books also in God's presence. Not only in God's presence, those books are related to us, the people of God. So please remember, though the Holy Spirit used Moses to write the first five books of the Bible, 1,500 years ago, before the time of Christ, books were not alien, books were not strange, they were known entities. As we proceed in the Bible, we notice books everywhere. Numbers 21:14. Wherefore, it is said in the book of the wars of the Lord, what God did in the Red Sea and the brooks of Arnon. We know the Red Sea story. And books of the wars of the Lord, it is not part of the Old Testament, it is not part of the canon. Lots and lots and lots of books which were not parts of the canon, they recorded everyday history. The more we read the Bible, the more it becomes clear to us that God taught the art of writing right from the time of Adam, and that the art of writing continued. And since the art of writing continued, people had the chronic habit of writing. I felt I should emphasize this because today we know that there are a lot of illiterate people around us. since there are a lot of illiterate people around us, we think that literacy is a modern phenomenon. That is wrong. Actually, the illiteracy around us is not a, the illiteracy around us is not a natural phenomenon. Rather, it is an artificial phenomenon. You may say, what do you mean, brother, by artificial phenomenon? Brothers and sisters, as we study the scripture, all of you should know that there are various forces in the society which deliberately keep people illiterate, deliberately. Let me give you one example. Some of you had commented recently about a brief article that I wrote on Facebook about the eunuchs in North India. We all know about eunuchs because the Bible mentions eunuchs. In North India, they are known as Hijda or Hijde. South India, in different languages and cultures, different words are used. I have been taking deep interest in them and sharing the gospel with them from the time I was 10. And I want to tell you something very surprising. Today, there are approximately 5 lakh eunuchs in India. 500,000, 5 lakh eunuchs in India. And almost all of them are illiterate. You may see them, most of them wear saris. You will see them moving in society. You will see them talking to people. You will see a lot of them, particularly in North India. Also in Maharashtra area, you will see a lot of them. Many of them are devoted to temples, but the majority of them are devoted either to begging or to prostitution. Surprisingly, in the 21st century India, the majority of eunuchs in North India are illiterate. Do you know why? They are kept illiterate by gangs of people who are exploiting them. In the same way, when you see any illiterate person, you may think that literacy is a new phenomena. No, literacy is not a new phenomena. Literacy, Bible has plenty of evidence to show that. Sorry. Bible has plenty of evidence to show that literacy started at the time of Adam, so much so that Adam was able to write Book of his genealogy. And the children of Adam were also able to write the book of genealogy. Today you pick up your Genesis, start reading, and there you will see book of such and such, book of such and such, book of. I picked up only one example from the Bible. God gave literacy as a gift to Adam, and from that time onwards, literacy has been widespread. And wherever there is illiteracy that is artificially imposed upon the society by people who exploit others by keeping them illiterate. This background is necessary because tomorrow when you say that you are a Christian, somebody is bound to ask these questions. So literacy started at the time of Adam. Excuse me. We read a lot and lots and lots. I have picked up only a few examples from the scripture to mention books which are mentioned in the Bible. Lot many more references are there. I have about 18 references here, but I'm not going to read all of them. I read only 3 or 4 of them. Then these are all books known to Jews and which were common among Jews, and also books with God. Before I close, I also want to tell you about another category of books. You may say, okay, Brother Johnson, Jews were probably literate. But there were a lot of non-Jews around. Do you think that they were also equally literate? I don't have to think. We have plenty of proof from archaeology, which shows that all ancient cultures were literate. And some of these books from outside the Bible are mentioned in the Bible. For example, please turn with me to Joshua 10:13. Joshua 10:13. And the sun stood still, and the moon stayed, until the people had avenged themselves upon their enemies. This is a record of the long day of Joshua. And then let us read, keep reading the verse. This is written in the book of Jashar. Jashar is a non-Jewish name. When a battle took place, kings were very particular in noting down details of the battle in their books. And archaeologists have discovered a lot of books in which kings have written about their battles. So this battle at the time of Joshua with Gentiles is recorded in a Gentile book known as Jashar, the book of Jashar. The correct pronunciation will be Yashir. King James Bible often uses the word J for year. The correct name of Joshua would be Joshua, and Jashir would be Yashir. There is a historical reason for that. I'll leave it at present. But please remember, the book of Yashir, which is a non-Jewish book, it contains details about the battle and the long day at the time of Joshua or Joshua. I would like to mention 2 more books before I close down the class today. And we find these books in 1 Kings chapter 14, verses 19 and 29. 1 Kings 14, verses 19 and 25. 1 Kings 14:19 says, and the rest of the acts of Jeroboam, how he warred and how he reigned, behold, they are written in the book of the Chronicles of the King of Israel. 29. Now the rest of the acts of Rehoboam and all that he did, are they not written in the book of the Chronicles of King of Judah? These are non-canonical books. What are Chronicles? I'm sure all of you remember the story of Esther when the king found it difficult to fall asleep. So they went to the library and pulled out a book, Daily Chronicles. Daily diary of the king, which was kept meticulously by dozens upon dozens of scribes, and they wrote down all the details of every day. And when it was read to the king says, oh, that man saved my life. Was anything done for him? No, Your Honor. And then the rest of the story is known to us. History and archaeology is our witness that in almost all cultures, people kept very detailed record of everyday events. And if there is anyone here who has a library science background, they know that even today there are institutions around the world which are devoted to keeping a record of everyday events around the world. There is a fine question. I will address it now. So this way, all cultures had the habit of keeping detailed books. The Bible did not drop out of heaven. Rather, God gave the art of writing to Adam, and from there, writings spread all over the world, and all the cultures had liberal writings. Tomorrow, if some theological radical or some Muslim comes and says, oh, Moses could not have written these books because, see, even in 20th century, there are illiterate people, and at the time of Moses, the art of writing was not known. You should face that person and you should be able to give apt reply. A question came to me whether any of these books have been found out. So many thousands upon thousands of volumes of these books have been found that even today scholars are struggling to translate them into English and publish them. I guess that all the books which archaeologists have found out, not even 1/10 have been published in English so far. They have been read in the original languages, but not published. So much has been found. Lord willing, in my next class, I will show you one or two books which have tried to publish the inscriptions related to the Bible. I thank God for giving that he gave me this kind of an opportunity. My apologies for the throat problem, but these are things not in my control. So thanks for enduring with me during my cough and clearing of throat and everything. If it has offended anyone, I apologize, and please pray that I might be given a better throat, Lord willing, in my next class.
Dear friends, I am confident that you enjoyed listening to this question answer video by Dr. Johnson C. Phillip. He would love to get your questions. Please post your questions in the comment box below this video and he will prepare a video reply for you. Please post only one question at a time, and make it as detailed as possible so that Dr. Phillip has no problem in understanding exactly what you mean. Also, please encourage this ministry by subscribing to this channel. Below this video, there is a subscribe button. Please click it. Also, please click the bell icon near it to complete the process of subscribing. Thank you very much for being such an encouragement to our channel.